Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Tom Lucanville. I'm the pastor here at Cypress Ridge. I'd like to welcome you all here as we've gathered here to lift our voices up and to rejoice in the Lord, the giver of new life. And so that's why we've gathered here, is to exalt God's glory. If you look in your bulletins to page 10, and under this week, due to various things, Tuesday morning men's Bible study that I'm going to be leading is going to get postponed for now. The Tuesday evening women's evening Bible study is going to get postponed, and the Wednesday evening BOP, which is Boathouse on the Patio, that's going to get postponed. So those three things will not be taking place this week. So we're gonna hold those off for a little bit. But if you do go back to the back page, if you like to bowl, there's a great opportunity for you. There's men's bowling available on January 21st. You can see the details there. And if you're interested, give a call. And if you're newer here at Cypress Ridge, or if you have a prayer request you'd like, there are cards in the seats in front of you. We invite you to take those out, and you can fill out your prayer request or fill out your information if you'd like to learn more about our church. If we go back to page 2 in your worship guide, and by the way, if you have electronic items, and like me, you've not yet quieted them, we invite you to do so at this time, so to silence any of your electronic devices. And here's our reflection on worship. This week, earlier in the week on Monday, I listened to a sermon from a guy up at the Journey Church in St. Louis, at one of those churches, and they gave this quote, and I thought, oh, that's good. And so I'd like you to see that. If you know enough of the good news to be saved by it, you know enough of the good news to tell others about it. Somebody ought to say, ooh, that's good. Isn't that good? All right, well, let's take a few moments of quiet time as we come to the Lord. Father God, we have gathered in this place to give you glory, to worship you, for you are the only true God. And Lord, we come and you give us peace. You give us understanding, which surpasses all understanding. And Lord, you are our comforter and you are our leader and our guide. And so we come to you this morning to worship you, to seek to be impacted by you and your truths. In Jesus' name, amen. For those who are able, I invite you to stand for our call to worship. From Daniel chapter 4. To all peoples, nations, and languages that dwell in all the earth, peace be multiplied to you. How great are his signs, how mighty his wonders. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and his dominion endures from generation to generation. Let us lift our voice up unto the Lord.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. O my soul, praise him, for he is thy help and salvation. O ye who hear, now to his praise to the Lord, let all stronger than any other name. How sweet the victory that bore my shame, took the burden of my sin away. Hallelujah! What a Savior! I owe everything to Him. Hallelujah!
Savior, hallelujah to my King.
is always in our memory verse. You know, kind of recap this a little bit. Just think of the message as you read through this. We're forgetting what lies behind and we're straying to what lies ahead. So we move out of the past into the present and look forward to God, how he's going to work in our lives in the future. So together, let's do our memory verse. Together, Philippians 3:13b-14. Forgetting what lies behind and straining towards what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Philippians 3:13-14. Let us pray together. Father God, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you that you are moving and active in our lives. And Lord, as we have our young ones here this morning, Lord, we thank you for them. Lord, we pray that you would be at work in their lives and in their hearts, changing them, drawing them ever closer to you. And Lord, as you do that, Lord, even at their age, may they be your representatives. May they learn how to talk to others and to learn and to be able to tell others about the love of Jesus that has so deeply loved us and impacted us. So, Lord, impact their hearts, impact their minds. And, Lord, we thank you for the faithful people that teach our children. Lord, would your blessings be upon them during this special time. We lift all this up in the mighty and the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. At this time, children are dismissed to go to children's worship, or if you'd like to return to your seats. All right, I invite you this morning to open your Bibles to Acts chapter 9. We'll begin at halfway through verse 19 where the paragraph break is, and we're going to look out through verse 26. So it's Acts 9 beginning at verse 19. Well, for us to understand the magnitude of this passage, I think we need to go back and kind of recap where we've come over the last couple weeks. Now, last week we had a break from it, but to go back and kind of remind us. And we started off talking about Saul, and Saul was a Pharisee amongst Pharisees. And what was he doing? He was ravaging the church. When people were convicted of following Jesus, he approved, he voted in favor of having them put to death. He even guarded the clothes of those who were stoning others. And so he was a bad guy, and he'd been persecuting Christians inside Jerusalem, but he'd heard that there were some up in Damascus. And so he went to the high priest to ask for letters to go to Damascus, so if he found any following Jesus there, he could bound him up and bring him back to Jerusalem to be tried and potentially put to death. So he was not your friend to Christians, you might say. Until one day he was on his way to Damascus, and Jesus shined down upon him in a bright, bright light and spoke to him and said, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And there was a short conversation between the two. And when Jesus left, Saul could no longer see. He was blinded, but there was a change that was beginning to take place in his heart. And so he was led on into Damascus. Well, while he was there, God was working on another guy. Remember that other guy's name is? Ananias. And so Jesus came to Ananias and said, "Ananias, I want you to go and lay hands on Saul and pray for him so that he might regain his sight and receive the Holy Spirit." And do you remember Ananias' response initially? He was afraid because of what Saul had done to believers, and he was a believer. But yet, through faith and trust in Jesus, he went and did as Jesus commanded him to do. He laid his hands on him, prayed over him, and something like scales fell from the eyes of Saul. And we believe he was filled with the Holy Spirit. He was baptized. And that's kind of where our story picks up today. Is this guy that was a despicable man was being changed and transformed. And so we're going to look at the question, how will we then live? And that's what we're going to see about Saul. How would he then live? So let's pick up our passage at verse 19 at the new paragraph break. For some days, he, being Saul, was with the disciples at Damascus. And immediately he proclaimed Jesus in the synagogue, saying, "He is the Son of God." And all who heard him were amazed. And he said, "Is not this the man who made havoc in Jerusalem of those who called upon this name? And has he not come here for this purpose, to bring them bound before the chief priest?" But Saul increased all the more in strength and confounded the Jews who lived in Damascus by proving that Jesus was the Christ. When many days had passed, the Jews plotted to kill him. But their plot became known to Saul. They were watching the gates day and night in order to kill him. But his disciples took him by night and let him down through an opening in the wall, lowering him in a basket. Let's commit this time to the Lord in prayer. Father God, as we come to your word, we thank you that you've given us your word. And Lord, we pray that your spirit would illuminate your words into our minds and in our hearts, Lord, that we might drink deeply of them, that we might see your call upon us and be drawn ever closer to serve you. In Jesus' name, amen. I got a couple items here. I don't know if you all can see them. But I got this big old glass bowl, and I got this egg. Who wonders what would happen if I took this egg and dropped it in that bowl? Anybody have any curiosity of what might take place? Anybody? Oops! Oh! It broke. It was impacted by the bowl. I just got to ask, what in the world is there about me in words? Okay. This thing was impacted, right? It's changed. It's transformed. All the king's horses and all the king's men can never put it back together again, right? This egg is forever changed because it's been impacted by this bowl. All right? Well, that's kind of true of us. Actually, it's exactly true of us. When we've been impacted, not by a bowl, but when we've been impacted by the Lord Jesus Christ, it's not a home improvement project. It's not a remodeling project. He makes us new. And I really like the way A.W. Tozer wrote this. So I'd like you to read to you this quote from A.W. Tozer. He said, "If God has laid hands on you, you will never be the same. If God has transformed you, and you are walking faithfully in him, you are in the position of seeing him do amazing things. Drug addicts and alcoholics reformed. Angry men and women exercising self-control. Liars exercising honesty. How? Because God does not improve us or remodel us. He transforms us into people that can exercise radical faith in obedience to him." Isn't that good? Isn't that good? See, we're not a remodeling project. God makes us new creations. And so the question for us is how will we then live? How are we going to live differently? Well, in our passage today we looked at, we see that Saul had been dramatically changed, dramatically transformed by the gospel. And so the question is how was he going to then live? What we see from him here and in other places is that believers are really called to be ambassadors for Christ. Believers are called to be ambassadors for Christ. So when you think of that term ambassador, what does that mean? Well, an ambassador is a high-ranking official that one country sends over to a foreign country, and when he's in that foreign country, he speaks and acts in authority of the sending country. So what he says is as though it's the words of the very country that sent him. And Paul calls us to be ambassadors. And let's see how he plays that out. So I invite you to turn in your Bibles to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and we'll pick up in verse 17. So, by the way, I really encourage you to bring your Bibles each week so you mark in them, you can underline things, you can put memory pegs in there. But we're going to start, I do have it here, but if you have your Bibles, do open it up. So this is what Paul, remember, Saul is his Hebrew name, Paul is his Greek name, all right? So, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Not a remodeled creation, not a do-over, but he is a new creation. See, Paul understood what that meant. He understood what it meant to leave that lifestyle behind of ravaging the church and breathing out threats and murder against followers of Jesus. He was made new. He was indeed a new creation. And then it continues to say, for the old is gone. See, his old ways of persecuting Jesus. And remember we saw earlier that Jesus said, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And Saul and persecuting Christians, in essence, there's such an intimacy between Jesus and his followers that in essence, he was persecuting Jesus himself. And so here, he said, the old is gone. The old persecution ways of persecuting Jesus and his followers is gone. But the new has come. Saul knew what it meant to put on new clothes, go in a new direction, have a new meaning and purpose, is that he was now proclaiming Jesus as the Son of God. So if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone. Behold, the new has come. And then it continues. Into verse 18, all this new life, all this new transformation is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself. He reconciled. See, we're over here separated from the love of God. It's because God is over here. And so Jesus came down to be the reconciler, to bring us into a right relationship with the Lord God Almighty. And he did that by going to the cross, by paying the penalty for our sins. Later it says, for him who knew no sin became sin. So he became sin so that we could be reconciled back into a right relationship with God. That's what Jesus did for us. But you know what? He doesn't just save us from something. He saves us to something. And what did he save us to? Saul/Paul understood that he'd been reconciled and God has given to us. He gave us, underline those words if you got your Bible, he gave us the ministry of reconciliation. See, he hasn't called us to be dividers as we see so much in the world around us today. He's called us to be reconcilers. Especially as we're going to see, for those who don't know Christ to those who do know Christ. But our mission is to be reconcilers, not divisive. Okay? So continuing on, he gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that is, in Christ. God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them. And what are the next words? Entrusting to us. See, God has trusted to us something to do. And he's passionate about us being obedient to it. And what is that? He's entrusted to us the message of, what's the word? Reconciliation. Do you understand what's going on here? God has put it upon his people to be reconciled. To be able to point people to Jesus in such a way. And then continues on. Therefore, we, what's the next word? Is it might? Is it should? Is it ought to be? No. If you're in Christ, we are ambassadors for Christ. It's a fact. We are ambassadors. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about this later, but when people know you're a Christian and they're a non-believer, they're watching what you do, how you act, and they're evaluating Christ based on what they see in you. Enough said, at least for the moment. All right, so we are, it's a fact, ambassadors for Christ. And then look at the rest of it. God is making his appeal. God is making his appeal for reconciliation through us. Man, what an exciting job God has given to us. As you leave here today, again, I'm going to get more into this later, but think of, I'm an ambassador for the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, that ought to give you some goosebumps if you're a believer. I'm an ambassador for Christ. And that's what Saul did, is he went from being a ravaging persecutor, breathing out threats and murder, approving of men and women being put to death, to being a proclaimer. And he was transformed. If you guys notice on your cover, Anna found this, or made this actually this week, you know, the caterpillar changing, metamorphosizing into the butterfly. When you see her again, tell her, ooh, that's pretty cool. So, but that's what had happened to Saul. See, he had been transformed, changed, and made a new creation. And so the question we might ask is how would he then live? How would he then live? Well, as we see in the first part of 19, what's the first thing he does? He begins to associate, he begins to hang out with other Christians. That's pretty cool, right? You know, maybe they were celebrating his conversion. Maybe they were talking about Jesus together, learning from one another. But it reminded me of Proverbs 27:17, where it says, iron sharpens iron, and one man sharpens another. So maybe there was a sharpening time that was taking place in their lives. So that's the first thing he did, is he began, as an ambassador for Christ, he began hanging out with Christians. Why? Because he was
transformed.
That's right, he was transformed. He was impacted by the gospel. But what was the next thing he did? If you continue on reading in your verse, it says, immediately he went out and began ranting and railing and talking about all the evils of that horrible Roman Empire and all the terrible things they were doing. And he began to rant and rave about how could these non-believing Jews not trust in Jesus. Is that what your translation says? That's why you need to have a Bible. So you can find out if what I'm saying is true or not. And what I just said is not true. He didn't do that. As a new creation in Christ, what did he do? He immediately went out and began to proclaim Christ. He got busy. He got busy by going into the synagogues, proclaiming Jesus, saying that Jesus was the Son of God. And by the way, the Son of God is a multifaceted title. But here in this context, it really points to the fact that he was promoting Jesus as the Son of God, that he was, from the Old Testament, he was the promised Messiah that was going to come. And so he began to promote Jesus as the Messiah, the Savior of the world, the Savior of sinners like us, that he was the Christ. So that's what Paul got busy. He hung out with the disciples, and then he got busy and started proclaiming Jesus. Now, do you understand the tension here? It was only a week or less that he was on his way to persecute. So if you don't think God can change hearts and change lives, nobody is beyond the reach of God. Amen. And when we're changed. It's new. The old is gone. The new has come. And so that's what he did here. And so the setting in Damascus must have been electric. Must have been electric, you know, because here these people were there. What they were hearing from Saul was in stark contrast of what they had heard about his reputation. See, they all thought he was coming there to persecute. And here he is. He's proclaiming. What had changed it? And they were confused. They were confounded. And it tells us that they began to ask themselves, and understandably so, is this the same guy that was in Jerusalem causing such havoc there? And causing havoc there amongst those who were believing in the name he's now promoting? That's in essence the first question. And then he said, didn't he come here to bound up and to take those same people back to the chief priest? In other words, what is going on? They couldn't understand the dramatic and drastic change that had taken place in the life of Saul. But if we've been impacted by the gospel, how are we going to then live? Are we going to live as we are impacted by the gospel? Or are we going to live according to the principles and the things that we think are going on in this world? So here he is. So they were confounded. So at some point, and here we don't have an exact timeline, but we believe that somewhere around verse 22 or 23, from Paul's testimony in Galatians chapter 1, he went off to Arabia. And when he was in Arabia, he got further instructed by the Lord Jesus Christ in Arabia. And then he came back to Damascus and ministered more there again. And we do know that the total time frame that he was in Damascus, Arabia, and back was some 3 years. So in that time frame, he was strengthened. And it tells us in verse, I'm in the wrong chapter. It tells us in verse 22 that he confounded the Jews. He confounded them. They were confused. They were astonished at what they were hearing because Saul was proving that Jesus was the Christ. Isn't that neat? And from reading the next few words, we know that some believed and some didn't. Some took it to heart and were changed by this news. Others were never changed. And the others that weren't changed, what did they begin to do? As it tells us in verse 23, they began plotting on how they could kill him. Now, do you see the irony? Here Saul had come from Jerusalem, the 135 to 150 miles, to Damascus, to hunt people down, to drag them back and maybe have them killed. And now he's there proclaiming the guy that he was persecuting. And now he's going to get persecuted. Remember back in Ananias' talk to him, when Jesus talked to him, he says, I'm going to show Saul how much he must suffer for my name. Well, it was pretty early on that he began to suffer. Okay? Nobody's called us to comfortability in Christianity. Just called us to be faithful. And so here he is, and so they're plotting against him, and somehow in God's providence, he revealed that to Saul. Saul must have told the disciples there, the Christian disciples, and because they protected him. But think about that. Again, there's irony. The people that he came to hurt were now saving him from being hurt. Do you see how two parties that were apart are being brought together because of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ? Not division, but unity. And so there he is. So they were there. And basically they made him, you might say, they made him a basket case. Come on, give me a little bit bigger. Ooh. A little more disgust in that. He was a basket case. Why did I say he was a basket case? Well, because the Jews that were plotting to kill him, they were out there guarding all the gates, both day and night, so he couldn't escape. The disciples were looking for to protect his life, so they loaded him up in a basket. That's right, in a basket, lowered him down to the wall, down out of the wall, down to the ground, and boom, off he went to Jerusalem, and we'll pick it up there next week, what takes place in Jerusalem. But I want us to see, do you understand the dramatic transformation that took place in the life of Saul? Because he was impacted by Jesus. And I got thinking about all this, and in the year 2000, Sandy and I started doing church planting up in Michigan. And while we were doing that, we went to a conference in Naperville, which is on the west side of Chicago. And we went to Naperville Presbyterian Church. And while we were there, the pastor told us a story about a lady in their church who had been impacted by the good news. And to answer the question how she began to live her life after that, she began to live as an ambassador for Christ. She began to live as an ambassador for Christ, and she lived in a cul-de-sac. And we heard a testimony from another gal that had been in that cul-de-sac. So that cul-de-sac was a highly materialistic area, very wealthy. To the point of, if one of the houses in the neighborhood put up a new chandelier, and others noticed it, and it was fancier than theirs, they would go out and buy new chandeliers so they could keep up with the Joneses. So they said, literally, I'm not making this stuff up. That's literally the way they were living in that neighborhood. Well, what did this lady do? She had been impacted by Jesus. She was an ambassador for Jesus. She didn't rail against him for materialism. She started a women's Bible study. One by one, she began gathering various women from the cul-de-sac. And they all then eventually started coming. And then her and husband, again, this took place over a period of time. Then her husband and herself, he'd been impacted as well. They started a small group amongst all those people there in their cul-de-sac. And in time, those people then, many of them, all of them in time, ended up going to the church. And over that time frame, the Lord changed and converted every one of them and made them new creations in Christ. Because one lady was an ambassador for Christ. She had a passion. She knew her mission, that we are called to be reconcilers and to do those things which bring reconciliation. Well, then she went to the pastor. And the pastor's telling us, he goes, when she first came to me and told me that she had to move, he said, inside of me, I have to tell you that my heart sunk. Because Naperville was a transient area, and he's thinking, oh, one of our best gatherers is going. But so he tried on the outward, put on a nice face, and he said, so why are you moving, and where are you moving to? And she goes, well, we haven't decided yet, but we're looking around. But I got to move because everybody in my cul-de-sac has come to church, has come to faith, and I need to go to a new neighborhood so I can be a witness to more people about Christ. Now, somebody ought to go, ooh, or amen, or wow, or, right? Is that not an ambassador for Christ? She brought people she knew to Christ. Uh-oh, I got to go find more. And she went off to look for more. And there is no exaggeration in this story. And you know I can exaggerate from time to time. But that's the way it was. So we might ask the question, well, I guess that timed out. So he might ask the question is how will we then live? If you've been impacted, if you've been transformed, if you've been changed by the Lord Jesus Christ, how will we then live? Well, once again, the first thing Saul did was he hung out with fellow Christians. He got to know them. Maybe they talked about stories about Jesus. They've been impacted. Iron sharpened iron. Who can say, I can do that? That sounds pretty doable. Build one another up. The next thing he did is he began proclaiming the name of Jesus. Ooh, how many cringe a little bit when you hear, oh, I got to proclaim Jesus? You know, that's outside my comfort zone. Good. Good. Because Jesus never called you to be comfortable. He called you to be an ambassador. Thank you. He called you to be an ambassador that's a witness of what he's done for us. Isn't that great? And he also tells us that when we go, you know, two things that often hold us back from going is the first one is, are they going to like what I have to say? Are they going to like it? In other words, kind of a fear of rejecting. What if they don't like what I say and they don't like? So we have a little bit of a fear of rejection, yes? Another thing that often holds us back is we think, well, they might not, I guess I maybe just don't know enough. I don't know enough to really be able to do it. Thus, we go back to our quote at the beginning of the sermon, or the beginning of our reflection on worship, which is, if you know enough of the gospel to be saved by it, you know enough of the gospel to tell others about it. Amen? Because, see, Jesus promised that he's going to send us the Holy Spirit to move and act within us. And he's even told us that he's going to give us words to speak when we need to speak those words. So we can proclaim Christ because the Spirit is moving in us. And then another thing I thought of is we need to imitate Christ as well. What did Christ often do? He often went out and did good deeds before he proclaimed the good news. And I got a quote. I love this quote. It's good deeds done with good friends produces goodwill and often opens up the door to share the good news. Good deeds done by good friends creates goodwill and leads often to the good news. Now, do we do good deeds so we can share the good news? No. We do good deeds because it's the right thing to do. But as a result of that, God often will open up doors for us. So that's another way we can be an ambassador for Christ. Got another question for us is how about the way I speak? How about the words I use, the language I use in my actions? Again, I'm a representative of Christ. When people look at me, they're looking, if they're an unbeliever, at me, kind of like, yeah, this guy's a representative of Christ. What's he like? So is the way we speak and the things that we do, is it winsome for Christ? Is it going to win some for Christ? Are we proclaiming the good news of who Jesus are? Or do they see the ranter and raver against the latest ideology or the latest this or all these other things we see raging in our land today, people looking for things to disagree about instead of being unifiers? You know, I've heard people say two things. I've heard people say, you know, I was around so-and-so, and I saw that they had something I didn't have. They had that inner sense of joy. They were peaceful. They were peacemakers. They weren't quarrelsome. I saw something in that person, realized they had something I didn't have. And in time, the Holy Spirit opened up my heart, and I realized what they had that I didn't have was Jesus. I've heard that in a high percentage of the testimonies I've heard people give about coming to Christ. They saw something that person had that they didn't have. I've also heard directly and indirectly the opposite. I saw this person who claimed to be a Christian say and do and argue about and da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And I thought, if they're a Christian, I don't want anything to do with them nor Christ. Now, that's a sobering thought, isn't it? But it's truth. It's I've heard it said. You know, and then that made me think of, what about, you're going to love this one, what about social media? What am I putting out there on social media? If Jesus were looking over my shoulder, would he go, maybe you put, that's not a good idea. Because is what am I putting out there, is it going to draw people to Christ, or is it going to alienate people from me and from Christ? Is what am I putting out here a divisive thing, or is it a promoting of Christ kind of a thing, or just about my family, or whatever social media was initially designed for? You know, what would Christ look at? And by the way, he is looking at your post, by the way. Because he is everywhere. He knows if you're putting enduring things, or he knows if you're putting divisive things out there. And this is what I got thinking about. Is remember way back in Joshua, the sentry call? When Joshua was out there and he was praying over the city and looking over the city, and the angel of the Lord appeared to him. And Joshua was kind of frightened. He goes, whose side are you on, ours or theirs? Remember what the angel said? In essence, he said, nope. He's not on either side. He said, I'm on the side of the Lord. That's the side we need to be on. If we're getting carried away with a particular ideology or against a particular ideology, or you guys understand what I'm saying here? We're going down the wrong path. Because read it today if you'd like. Romans 13 is really clear. Nobody serves in power except the Lord appoints them. And the Lord appoints them for a reason and for a purpose. We might like it, we might not like it. But we better like it because it's God in charge. Somebody say amen, please. Can I say that again? We might like it or we might not like it. But the Bible's clear that God is the one that appoints people to power. What are we going to learn in the days ahead? No matter who's in charge. What we need to say is, nope, my allegiance is to the Lord God Almighty. And that's how we live as ambassadors for Christ. Because again, people are watching us. They're looking at us. People right now are hungry for answers. Because there's so much craziness going on around us. And so we all have great opportunities right now to be ambassadors for Christ, to show the love of Christ, to show the care of Christ, maybe starting up our own Bible studies, maybe starting up our own small groups, but looking out and doing good works with good friends, bringing goodwill so we can present the good news. We need to be our eyes out into the world. Who can we help and how? And maybe God will give us an opportunity to point them to Jesus. That's our allegiance. Our allegiance is to Christ Almighty. If you say amen, I'll think about stopping.
Amen.
One final statement, and then I'll say it. How shall we then live as ambassadors for Christ? In all that we say, in all that we do. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your word. And Lord, it convicts us in a lot of ways. But Lord, we know that your spirit is at work within us. And so Lord, we know there's so many things going on, whirling in this world around us. That's got things so crazy and so confusing. But we know that you can make sense out of all things. And so Lord, would your spirit draw our hearts so that we are loyal to you, and that, Lord, we become great ambassadors for Christ. Because he's the one that reconciled us to you. And so, Lord, you've given us the ministry of reconciliation. So would your spirit guide us and direct us. Draw us closer to you. And, Lord, would you give us opportunities, maybe even this week, to point others to the love of Christ. Would you do that, Lord? In Jesus' name, amen. As the worship team comes forward, I invite you to turn in your bulletins to page 6 and let us stand together and sing about who our Messiah is, the Lord Jesus Christ.
The ransom from heaven.
Jesus Messiah. Lord of all, his body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out, all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so
You know, I really enjoy a lot reading the Lord's Word, because so often it's like a knife piercing into my heart, but then when it's withdrawn, it's clean because it's been washed by grace. So by coming to His Word and reading His Word, we do get convicted, but then we're remembered, we're covered by His grace, by His love, and that draws us to want to live for Him even more. To be drawn ever closer to Him. And so as we hear His Word, it's good for us to be drawn to confess our sins, to repent of our sins, and to lift our eyes up to Him and plead with the Spirit that He would guide us and direct us, and we'd listen and follow Him. So as we confess our sins, from Ephesians 2, but God being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which He loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. Ooh, amen. Let's take a few moments of silent confession. Lord, as we come before You, we recognize that there are at least in my case, there's a lot of things that I need to take off. And yet, Lord, there's many things I need to put on. And so, Lord, we just pray that your Spirit would be it moving within us. And Lord, that your Spirit would continually be at work within us so that we might lift our eyes above and out of the things of this world. And so, Lord, we thank you for your grace and your forgiveness. Even when we were dead in our sins and trespasses, Christ died for us. Thank you, amen, and hallelujah for doing that for us, Lord God. And Lord, as we continue to walk here on this earth, you know, there's things that happen to us here, and there is physical ailments that come along. And Lord, you know the list of people in our worship guides here that are struggling from a health standpoint. And Lord, we just ask that you would wrap your loving arms around each and every one of them. And yet, Lord, we know that this list isn't all-inclusive, that there are others that have been stricken with various things. And so, Lord, we just pray that your strength and your comfort to face these challenges would be with them. Lord, that your grace and your mercy would be poured out upon them. And that, Lord Jesus, we know that you are the great physician. So we ask that your hand would be upon them, giving them strength, giving them peace. And Lord, heal them. And Lord, as we go on, we know there's many needs for jobs and other things around us. But Lord, our greatest need is to remember that you are our Savior and that we get to be your ambassadors. Oh, Lord, what a blessing. What a blessing. So would your Spirit guide us that we might walk faithfully as ambassadors for Christ, as though you are making your appeal to the lost world around us through us, what we say and what we do. Amen. Let's pray together those words that our Lord Jesus taught us to pray. He said, "Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Well, we thank you for your great faithfulness in supporting the Lord's ministry here at Cypress Ridge and through the ministry here at Cypress Ridge, and we encourage you to continue doing that. Each week we have offering plates here. You can mail your check in, drop it off, or you can even do online giving should you choose to do that. From Exodus 23, we see these words about returning to the Lord a portion of what he's given to us. "The best of the first fruits of your ground you shall bring into the house of the Lord your God." May it be so. Well, believers, what do we believe? Let's stand and sing, "We Believe."
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe. In this broken generation, dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and he's given us new We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptation,
the first two verses of the song we just sang. In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, does that sound like today?
Oh, yeah.
There is only one foundation. We believe, we believe. There is a foundation. In this broken generation, when all is dark, is that true today? Yeah. You help us see there is only one salvation. We believe, we believe. But something else for us to remember. Is this the first time there's been a time of desperation?
Yeah.
Is this the first time where things have felt like it's all darkness?
Yeah.
You can go back 1,000 years plus, and there's always a time. But there's good news.
Amen.
There's one that's in control during this entire time. It is the Lord God Almighty. And it's Him we serve, and Him alone. It's Him that deserves our loyalty, and Him alone. And so we come before Him, recognizing what He's done for us, remembering the incredible gift of new life that He's given to us, that He's made us a new creation, that the old indeed is gone, the new indeed has come. And we are new in the Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, we are His ambassadors. What a treat, what a joy, what a delight. So as we come to this table, let us remember not only the issues we are personally dealing with, but being thankful that God isn't surprised. He knows what's taking place. And He's in charge. May we look to Him. So as we come to this table, we're reminded that this table is for those who believe and are trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ and have made a profession of faith in Jesus as the one and only true Savior. If you've not come to that point yet, we would ask that you would not partake of this table. But if you have come to faith in Jesus and made that profession, with great joy, we come before the King of the universe to receive what he's given to us. So let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for your incredible love. Thank you for the knowledge that we have that you are in charge, that you are not surprised by anything going on here. And that, Lord, we know that you know the end from the beginning. So, Lord, may our trust be in you. And as we contemplate our lives, Lord, may your spirit move within us to show us how we can be like Christ and how we can be his ambassadors. It's in his name we pray. Amen. On that night Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat in remembrance of me until I come again." And what a day of rejoicing that will be. So in his name, we serve you this bread. You'll notice in the baskets that are passed that there are cups that have gluten-free for those who need gluten-free. As our officers come by, we ask that you would cup your hands. And if you need gluten-free, indicate to them and they will give you gluten-free, but they'll drop the bread into your hand. So do that. We ask that you would hold the element until all have been served so that in unity of Christ we can partake together. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone. Behold, the new has come. Praise God. Take and eat. That same evening, Jesus took the cup. He said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, which is in my blood, which has been shed for the remission of sins for many. Take and drink all of it in remembrance of me." Ministering to you in his name, we serve you this cup. The outer circle of cups have grape juice. The inner circles are wine. Indicate to the elders which you would prefer, and they will give you, that's what they will give you. Hold once again until all have been served, so that in the unity of Christ we may partake together. For God the Father made God the Son to know sin who knew no sin, or to become sin who knew no sin, so that we might become the righteousness of God. Praise be to God for his gift. Take and drink. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your incredible love and for the gift of new life. Lord, as we have come to this table to remember so many things about what you've done for us, and yet the table here is present with us, just as we know you are here and you are present with us in a wonderful and a special way. So, Lord, we ask that you would move in our heart, that the Holy Spirit would gather us up to strengthen us in our resistance to sin, to grow us in our faith, to impassion us to go and take the good news to the nations. Lord, we ask that your Spirit would do this. In Jesus' name, amen. Following the worship service, we ask that, I know we've joked a little bit about this, but this disease out there is crazy right now, and there is a lot of people being affected in a lot of ways, and so do keep, and I'm going to use the words this week, social distance from one another. Do that. Keep that proper distance from one another. Take proper precautions. And I hate air hugs, but do, you know, but do that. Amen? Let us stand and receive the benediction that comes from our Lord. We lift our hands up to the Lord as his love has been poured down upon us. Let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us and establish the work of our hands. Amen. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.